Hello, this is Scottish Independence Podcast, episode number 159. Last night, the SNP Club in Edinburgh invited Colin Fox, the leader of the Scottish Socialist Party, to give a talk there. Someone from the SSP recorded it, so thanks to them, and also thanks to the SNP Club in Edinburgh, because that gives me the chance to let you all hear it as well. No messing about, we'll just go straight to it, and I'll have a wee word with you at the end.
This evening, well, it's very appropriate that this evening's speaker is on my left.
Mama, everybody's left. Yeah.
Well, I would say this, I'm a bit schizophrenic about this evening because the SNP is my political party, but I think my spiritual home is more over here.
That's
for those who know me will appreciate that. Why is Colin here? Well, Colin's here because Colin and his party are very, very important partners in the drive towards independence. And I also regard Colin and his party as critical friends. And our party needs critical friends, people to test and try our ideas, our policies, as we move forward into independence. So, can I introduce our critical friend, great campaigner, Collins.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much, Roy. And can I just say, I find this very premises part of my spiritual home. I've been in here many times before during the referendum campaign. And yesterday, our friends and family, or not yesterday, but during the referendum campaign, next door we used to have the Scottish Socialist Party Executive Committee meetings. So if we had a bigger executive, we'd had it in here, but we just had it in there. So first thing I wanted to say, Roy, and to yourselves is thank you very much for inviting me along to the club and also to share our Friday night with you. It's a great privilege and a pleasure to be here, and I think that I certainly personally feel part of the independence family, always have done. I've been part of that family for a long time. And like the best of families, you know, you have your differences of opinion, your hip supporters and your heart supporters, you have your mother supporter, and you have your Celtic Rangers supporters. So I'm grateful for the opportunity to talk to you. I think there's an awful lot to talk about. And I have to say, I've been involved in politics now for 40 years. And it sometimes feels as if I've been next to Wellington's horse for 40 years every day. I get people who see me in the bus, like a couple of friends tonight, and say, "What's your name again?" And they say to me, "You're that guy." I'm on the 31 bus, "You're that guy, aren't you?" And I goes, "Aye, Colin Fox is my name." "Oh, I don't know your name, mate. I just see that horse every single day." And I say, "I'm not at that horse every day." Aye, every day I go past that horse, there you are. So much so, and this is the truth, I was telling Ray before, if you get your mobile phone out, and I'm not advising you to do it just now, but when you go home, go on Google Maps. I got this tweet from a woman in Australia last week. She's tracing her family tree, and she's due to come over to register house soon. She's for the Douglas clan. And she says, she sent me a tweet, a message on Twitter saying, "I'm not kidding you, I'm due over to register house in Edinburgh in 3 months' time." She says, "I went on Google Maps to find where it was, and I went right down to the, you know, the actual pictures that they put in Google Maps, and they're wrapped around the Duke of Wellington's banner for an independent socialist Scotland Socialist Party, and me and Eddie." And I thought, Google Maps, me and Ben Nevis together, what can I say? So I'm a feature of Google Maps, so I've not been doing it for 40 years, but I feel as if I've been rewarded. I don't need to do it anymore. It reminded me, actually, that anecdote about being there every day. My dad used to say to me as a wee laddie, he says, "Son, if you get a reputation for getting up at 6:30 in the morning, you can still be in your bed at 10 o'clock. So I won't be at the Duke of Wellington horse tomorrow, I'm sorry to say. Now I'm built up to it, usually at the mound on a Saturday. Anyway, I feel, you know, part of the family here. I wanted to say at the very outset, the Scottish Socialist Party has been immensely proud of our role in the independence movement. Not just in the 20 years that the Scottish Socialist Party has been going. We're proud to have been the founders, or co-founders, to be accurate, of the Yes Scotland campaign. Proud to be co-founders of the Scottish Independence Convention, along with the SNP and the Greens, way back in 2005. Proud to be founders of the Radical Independence Campaign. But in truth, I consider the origins of the support I have for independence can be traced back 100 years. Funnily enough, in this week's issue of the Scottish Socialist Voice, that I'm sure you all subscribe to, and if you don't, you should. But there's a review of a book in here about R.B. Cunningham Graham. Yeah. And it's a book, if I can just find the review amongst these Gestetner notes, next to my article about Brexit, and a review of 50, the death of Che Guevara. It's a book review, An Eagle in the Henhouse, about the selected writings of R.B. Cunningham Graham. And it reminds you, in the 1890s, R.B. Cunningham Graham was advocating for independence more than a century ago. And I feel the Scottish Socialist Party, because R.B. Cunningham Graham, although he was a Liberal MP at the time, he considered himself a socialist, a radical, and he was in support of independence. The same tradition that James Connolly belongs to, the same tradition that John McLean belongs to. And I'm proud of that tradition, because it wasn't easy then. It hasn't been easy to support independence for the last 125 years. And I'm sure we've never forgotten that. But we also realise there wouldn't be so many of us here, and we wouldn't have achieved half the things that we've achieved without their contribution a century ago or 50 years ago, or Wendy Wood at the Mound, or the contribution that people have advocated independence for a long, long time. So I only consider me passing on the baton, really. I might see independence in my lifetime. God, I hope so. But if I don't, I'll be satisfied that I played my part in passing it on to the next generation who will. And it's in those sentiment, really, that I feel that when you're part of a family, you can speak frankly to each other. I don't have to come here and make the case for independence, do I? We know the case for independence. We're persuaded of it. Our job is to persuade others. Our job is to build capacity. Our job is to understand why people who don't support independence just now don't support it, and try and persuade them, not by hectoring them, but saying, what are your objections? What are your fears? And often, we've heard them so many times that, by and large, the biggest objection, if that's the case, to independence is the sense that, well, it's aye been, like they say in the Borders, it's aye been, Scotland's aye been part of the Union for 300 years, do you know? It's aye been, so why do we need to change it? And it's our job to say, because you could have something better. You can have something better. We're not going to change it for change's sake. We're changing it into something better. And my aim is to see an independent socialist Scotland. I want to see a modern democratic republic in 21st century Scotland, because I think that's where Scotland deserves to stand in the modern world. That's my contribution to this, the family and debate. I respect others who have a different point of view. And what we've all agreed on is that independence is such a colossal achievement. What in effect we are saying to each other is, none of us here are about to underestimate our opponents. I think it's interesting, this year, Roy, remember, is the anniversary of the partition of India and Pakistan, 1947, when the British state had India, because there was only an India then. There wasn't a Pakistan, there wasn't a Bangladesh, there was only an India. And in getting out, they left behind a pogrom, a massacre of Hindus and Muslims, of which you see just the smallest vignette in Burma today, and the intolerance that's there. And I see what the British state did in Ireland, in India, in Africa, and the rest of the world. They're an imperial power. They still think the same way. Their objections to independence is, Scotland is its independence. We lose our seat in the UN Security Council. We use our status as a big power in the world, the fifth biggest military power in the world, sixth biggest economic power. That's what they're about. And I know in this audience, I certainly don't have to make the point that none of us here will ever underestimate our opponents. We don't ask for any quarter to be given, and we won't be giving them any quarter either. We don't underestimate what they're prepared to do. And I know, and you know, they will die in a ditch to protect the political union that is the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. Therefore, this is a serious, serious campaign. This is an issue that's worth winning, but it won't be won easy. It won't probably won in the short term, and it won't be won without a great deal of sacrifice and a contribution, both intellectual and human, to achieve that goal. I'm aware of that. I'm reconciled to that. And my attitude is that the goal, when it's achieved, will be all the more glorious, because it won't just be a straight 5-0 victory over Motherwell. It'll be a victory that's won in the last minute of extra time, because we deserved it and ours was a superior case. And so it's in that context I offer you my remarks about where we are just now. I'm a Marxist. Karl Marx once famously said, out of conflict comes clarity. You learn a great deal more in debates where you see different points of view put in front of you. If we're all blindly following the same script, then we might be great singers in the chorus, but we don't learn too much beyond the script. And I've always understood the importance of discussion and debate, and I have to say I'm proud of many things I've achieved in my life, but I've been, I suppose, gifted by my parents with an ability. I can discuss and have differences of opinion with people, I don't have to follow up with them. They don't become my sworn enemies just because they don't agree with what I agree with or I don't agree with them. You know, we live, we move on, history will consider, you know, history will absolve me, as they say. Experience will decide who's right and wrong, if there is indeed such a thing. I'm not worried about conflict, I'm not worried about it, I think it helps the debate. And one of the things I say about the independence movement could benefit from a great deal more dissident voices. The more people thinking about an issue, engaged in it properly, constructively, with a contribution that's about trying to find an end goal and finding the answer to a problem, we should never turn that down. We will never ever, there's only 5.25 million, we will have never ever have too many thinkers, too many intellectuals. We will never have too many people focused on answers to problems that we can say, oh, we don't need it, or we're going to turn somebody's point of view away. And therefore, my attitude is, I was at Jim Sillars' 80th birthday party on Wednesday. Had a lovely time. Jim's 80, and he's one of those dissident voices, discordant voices. And I find myself with Jim, Alec Neil was there, various other people, and I find myself, I don't always agree with what they have to say, but I feel strengthened by their contribution, that there's an intellectual rigour and there's a passion there. And therefore, I think that's healthy. I think when you've got a point of view that's aiming to achieve the same goal and objective, then you don't have to agree. I don't agree with Jim and fracking, I don't agree with Jim and lots of things, but we've never fell out. And I hope I don't fall out with anybody here tonight, although I seem to be building that up to a crescendo. So I'm moving on to say, a year is a long time in politics. Harold Wilson was right 52 times over, because I'm thinking of this time last year, right? Last October, Theresa May was a shoo-in for the general election. She never needed strepsils. She was ahead in the polls. She was rousting Jeremy Corbyn every week on Prime Minister's questions, wasn't she? And the only thing that contained her attention was constant rumours that she was about to call a general election, and she says, no, no, never, I'll never do that. So a year ago, look where Theresa May was. A year ago, look where Jeremy Corbyn was. He had just went through another leadership battle in the Labour Party, which looked at that stage as if they're going to be annual affairs, because that's the second one he fought in 2 years. The right wing in the Labour Party, people like Ian Murray, to give them a visual, you know, human face, hate his guts, you know, hate his guts. And, you know, they just planned, or failed to plan, failed to carry out a coup d'etat, didn't they? They all resigned en masse because they didn't like him. They still don't like him. But a year ago, Corbyn couldn't do anything right, and the bookies had them long odds on for being the first party leader to get bumped. And a year ago, the SNP were engaged in a discussion about whether or not we were going to have a second referendum on independence before Brexit, before 2009, and were able to announce that they'd broken records as far as their membership were concerned. 120,000, you'll know better than I. A year later, look where we are. Theresa May today. I picked up the Metro and the 31 coming down here on the front page of the Metros. She'll be gone today. And I know that was printed yesterday, right? But it's far. I know it's only 7:45 and I didn't see the news, so if you know better than I, right? But she's toast. He's finished. At Jim's party, Alan Cochran was there for the Daily Telegraph. And when I say he was there, right there, sat next to me the whole night, right? So we had a great old ding-dong about Thatcher and things like that. Anyway, and he was saying, she's finished. They're going to get rid of her. And they are, aren't they? You can tell she is dead meat. They're going to do her in. And the 6 o'clock news, Eddie Mayer, 5 o'clock news, Eddie Mayer was talking about, it's David Davis is the stop Boris candidate, right? David Davis. And I thought, David Davis, he was the guy that Cameron pumped, remember? He was supposed to be a shoe-in, and Cameron wins it on the basis of, he could talk without notes. Hey, Al Diaz, a Tory leader, could talk without notes. That David Davis is reading him like that, you know, the cats that on them are, right? He's going to be the next leader, according to the Tories. But look how that has utterly changed.